Control. Hello and welcome to another Hoeg Law Postmortem. This time about a video game, which we haven't done in some time, if at all. We usually do impressions of video games, because I don't get the chance to finish a lot of the games that I purchase or otherwise play. But today we're going to talk about a game I finished over this past weekend and week called Control, which is from Remedy Entertainment, and is a bit of a spiritual follow-up to one of my personal favorite games of all time, a game called Alan Wake, which takes a more horror bent and is about novelists and writing and the act of creation. And as part of this video and podcast, Alan Wake is going to be a topic that comes up time and time again. Not only because I'm obsessed with Alan Wake, I think it's a fantastic game, as I said, it's one of my top 10 of all time, but also because this game, Control, winds up taking narrative elements, plot elements from Alan Wake, and talking about them. Sometimes to good effect, I think very often to not so good effect, and I want to talk about that a little bit, because I think that's an important part of the Control puzzle, that this is actually a kind of spiritual side sequel to Alan Wake. Control clearly takes place in the Alan Wake universe. I don't really think that's a spoiler. But if you're not familiar with Hoeg Law Postmortems, I think now is a great time to mention that these are going to be spoiler-filled. This is a game that I have beaten, and so we're going to talk a lot about things that happen late in the game, things that I like, things that I have a problem with. And I'm going to try to keep at the front end of this conversation the non-spoiler type items. We're going to talk about the basic efficacy of the graphics and sound and music and other things in the game itself. But at a certain point, I really want to talk about the storyline, the narrative, the characters, what Control actually is, what Remedy has put on the table here. And because that's the most important part of the conversation, I really think that's going to be probably the second half of this video and podcast. And I will try to remember to say when I start talking about narrative that that's when the spoilers are really, really going to hit. Although there might be some light spoilers if you're really sensitive to that, if you're really looking forward to Control at the front end of this video as well. So if you are, if you're really sensitive, please come back after you've gotten a crack at Control. I won't mind. I think we'll have a good discussion here. I look forward to people commenting on this video because I think that there's going to be a lot of different opinions on this game. I've already seen after I put some of my initial thoughts out on Twitter, at Hoeg Law, follow if you're so inclined, that there was a lot of pushback to what I had to say about the game, and I thought that was interesting. I've always said I love reasonable disagreement. If you can back up your position, I love to have that conversation because while we might not be able to convince each other, we can have a better understanding of our different perspectives and hopefully wind up enjoying more and more of the pop culture items that we might otherwise not enjoy. That's really what I'm looking for, is to have good, intelligent discussion about these things, which is all a very long way of saying Control is going to be definitively my most disappointing game of 2019. Now, when I say disappointing, I think it's important to put that in context. Tom Chick, who has been one of my favorite video game reviewers for really as long as I can remember, he used to write for PC Gamer. He now has his own website called Quarter to Three, which I highly recommend, exactly as it sounds, quartertothree.com. He does reviews all the time. He talks about games of the year and games he didn't like, and he has a great description of what it means to be disappointing. So I'm going to just read it from here. This is one of the years where he talked about his most disappointing games. He says, calling a game disappointing arguably has more to do with me than the game itself. Disappointment isn't an inherent quality. It can't exist without some sort of expectation in the first place. In many cases, these games are sequels or the creations of developers with proven track records or entries in established genres or games with promising beginnings. But for various reasons, a central fact about these games is that I had personally hoped they would be better. Now, as you could probably tell from the introduction to this video, I had a great deal of hope for Control. This was Remedy Entertainment, Remedy Games, going back to the well of dealing with the supernatural, dealing with the paranormal, what it means to be afraid of something, what it means to not understand what it is that you're seeing, various things that are reflective of their game, Alan Wake, that's one of my favorite of all time. Unfortunately, this game fell down a lot for me. And that's why it's my most disappointing game of the year. I had anticipated it to be in my end of year game of the year conversation, and it will definitively not be. And so that means it's my most disappointing game. It very much might not be your most disappointing game. We're going to talk about all the things it does well. It might be one of your favorite games of the year, depending on how you weigh the various different aspects of the game. It does a lot of things well. What it doesn't do well, in my opinion, is narrative and story structure, and we're going to get to that. But in terms of action game, doing some things that Remedy hadn't done before, it does some things well. I can certainly see why a lot of people like it. And certainly when I go out on Twitter or social media or even with this video and podcast, there are going to be a number of folks that say, Rick, you're crazy. This is not as bad a game as you are suggesting that it is. And I'm not going to argue with that point. I'm going to say it wasn't what I was expecting from Remedy. And so it was disappointing to me. But if it's great for you, I will never, ever take that away from anybody. I want it to be great. I want everything that you play, that you watch, that you experience, that you read to be great for you. If that could be the same for everybody, that would be awesome. But different people are going to react differently to different things. So let's talk about what Control actually is. So in Control, you take the character of Jesse Faden, who's a young woman who shows up at the Federal Bureau of Control, which is a kind of standard government-looking building. It's got architecture that I think is most commonly described as brutalist. And if you're not familiar with that term, it essentially means giant gray slabs at high levels of angle that look like it was created to be some kind of Siberian prison compound. There are a number of government buildings in Washington and elsewhere that have this look about them, a lot of gray corners. And the Federal Bureau of Control is designed to do that. Now, from a story perspective, it's designed to do that because it's supposed to look like a government building that does office work. And indeed, some of the really good humor, some of the really good environmental detail and kind of environmental storytelling that the game does is essentially concept that there's this paranormal federal bureau and that they're otherwise just a bureaucracy. You collect a lot of collectibles that talk about mundane things like, hey, you know, if all the pages in your printer turn pink, back away and call human resources and things of that nature that just kind of take, hey, if we were acting in a weird capacity, but we were also a bureaucratic office building, how would our memos look? How would our files look? And that kind of combination, which exists mostly at the beginning of the game before things get weirder and weirder and weirder, is fun. It's great fun. It's environmental detail. It's very much like Rapture, if you're familiar with the BioShock series or these other games that really focus on establishing an interesting environment to take place in. And Control does that well. I will never take away the fact that Control's environmental detail is really second to none. It has a number of things within its environment, a number of things that you can collect, a number of things that you can read, straight up signage on the walls of the building and things of that nature that make you feel like you're in an actual place, even if it's an actual place that is very, very weird. And that's going to be, in my opinion, the height of the game if you're looking for storytelling, if you're looking for narrative, is the effort that Remedy has done on this game has really existed in that capacity. In terms of the graphics of this game, you're going to see something that, if you have played it, will remind you a lot of Quantum Break. Quantum Break being their time travel game that came out pretty close to the launch of the Xbox One, was a Microsoft exclusive. I think it might have found its way to PC, but basically in that game, you are running around, shooting people, and also using time travel powers. And those time travel powers take the place of things like time shield, time balls. And you can see a very clear lineage from Quantum Break through to Control, where now, yes, you get different powers. You can throw things with your mind and things of that nature, but it's a similar kind of concept to Quantum Break. And the graphics kind of bear that out. Some of the best stuff in Quantum Break takes place in industrial settings, in cafeterias, and in places that you might recognize in real life. And Control kind of takes that up to 11. Hey, here's a full office building. Here you've stumbled onto the cafeteria or the copy room, but also there's psychic demons that are here to fight you, and you can rip a piece off the wall and throw it at them with your mind. And that's really what they try to accomplish in Control, and I think they do that well as well. So the graphics are good, although I have seen that a number of people on earlier consoles, I'm playing on an Xbox One X when I played through it this past weekend and week, that earlier consoles are having some difficulty with it. I think there's some issues. I think I would be remiss to not point out a significant bug that does have an impact on the game. You know, this game is structured as what I think is described most often as a Metroidvania, which is a term of art that I don't love because I don't think it's limited to kind of Metroid or Castlevania games, but it basically means this. The game ostensibly has one single map that you can roam around in as you will, only it has pieces that are locked off until you get certain things and you can backtrack through and gain access to these additional areas after you've progressed a certain point through the story and the narrative. In this case, some of them are locked off by locomotion skills that you'll get, such as levitation, which appears in the trailer of the game, which I thought was interesting because you get it so late in the game, but it is in the trailer, so whether or not you consider that a spoiler is really up to you. But also through clearance cards. They've got doors in this office building that have a clearance level 1 through 6, I think, is the top end. And you get those cards as you progress through the story, and then you can go back, you can open up things, you can use certain weapons to blow apart walls and find secrets. And that's very akin, in many people's eyes, to the original Metroid, to Castlevania Symphony of the Night, and on, where you have this kind of backtracking. And so it winds up being called a Metroidvania. The issue that I was raising is that in a Metroidvania, one of the things that's really of paramount importance is understanding where you are. And potentially, where are things that you've left behind that you can go back to now that you've gained clearance level 3. In this case, there's a map that you can access that has two major problems with it. One, when the map works, it layers an upper level and a lower level on top of what it's showing you as the main level of any floor that you're on. And so what it winds up doing is it creates a certain density of the map that is almost impossible to read, certainly early on. You might get it a little bit better as you go on, but it's almost designed, much like the layout of the building, to be deliberately obfuscatory. It's designed to disorient you as to where you are at. To some extent, I think that's a good thing. It forces you to read the signs in the office building that you're in and figure out how to get to where you're going by reading those signs, just as you might do if you were a human being that didn't have access to hitting a button and having a map pop in front of your face. So I think there is some good there, and I think they didn't want you to lean on the map too hard, but it's not terribly useful, and for a game like this, it maybe isn't the best idea. The bigger problem, by far the bigger problem, is that, at least for me, about 80% of the time that you would go to hit the map button, all you would get were the labels of the various rooms, and you wouldn't actually get the map. So you could get some kind of broad understanding of where they were in relation to each other, but you wouldn't get a map in and of itself. And for a game like this, which determines that you have to navigate yourself through very Byzantine and obfuscating doorways and passageways and stairs to nowhere and things of that nature, having your map not work 80% of the time is a significant technical fault. I actually can't imagine that it was a bug that they wound up shipping with, other than the fact that it doesn't impact your moment-to-moment gameplay. It certainly impacts your ability to enjoy that gameplay when you can't figure out how to get from point X to point Y. And so I think they shipped with that bug. I don't love that. I think that's a significant problem. I've heard of other people having more technical problems. I will tell you, on the Xbox One X, there absolutely were sequences and circumstances that would have the frame rate drop to some low level, teens or something along those lines, particularly when they've got a lot of enemies that are throwing rocks around and there's a lot of particle effects. And so I do think if you are developing a game like that, you have to be cognizant of exactly what your technical limitations are. I can't imagine playing it on the original Xbox One, for instance. I don't know how it works on there, but I do think there are technical issues, and Remedy has pretty much always had certain amount of technical issues, so I think that's okay. I don't think they, in the long run, detract from the overall enjoyment of the game, but certainly in the short run, not being able to access that map was a problem. In terms of sound effects and music, you know, I think it's pretty pedestrian. You've got screeching monsters, you've got nice gun sounds. In terms of the music itself, it's not very good, but that's going to be up to your personal taste. It's very percussive, it's kind of synthy, and it's not very melodic. And so I think it's designed to put you at unease. You're dealing with an interdimensional invasion, essentially, and it's mostly music that doesn't really make you calm. It's designed to make you anxious, and it did its job, I suppose. But in terms of, you know, the music in Quantum Break, the music in Alan Wake is more traditional, strings and horns and things of that nature that you might expect in a big budget action movie of some kind. And Control is an action game above all. Although I said you can collect all these collectibles from various places and various pieces of the office building, 90% of your time is going to be flinging things at monsters that show up out of nowhere and that you fight in waves in order to either protect something or get access to something. And that is the bulk of the game. There aren't a lot of puzzles. There aren't a lot of soft kind of walking moments in the middle of the game. Certainly there are some at the beginning. And so you've got this action game. You've got this percussive music. The one exception to this complaint is that there is an excellent sequence, which is called the Ashtray Maze, I believe, that uses a trick that Remedy has used before. Namely, they put music on from Poets of the Fall, which they call Old Gods of Asgard in their universe of Remedy games, including Alan Wake. And they have a sequence where you essentially fight through a kind of Inception hotel that is constantly shifting while you have this rock music on that is music that is also portraying the plot of the game and your character, Jesse. And it's a wonderful sequence. I say it's a trick they've gone to before because it's a sequence that is almost identical to Alan Wake fighting against the darkness with music from the Old Gods of Asgard playing while he fights on a concert stage against the darkness, and they play a song that is all about the darkness and the light that Alan Wake is dealing with. So it's a well they've gone to before. It is a well that continues to succeed for them, so it's excellent. I don't have any problem with them using it. It is the highlight of the game, in my opinion. It's a pity that it's a highlight that is so reflective of another highlight of a game that I think is much better. And so that's really the ultimate kind of thing that I would say about Control, is that this feels like Remedy trying to branch out. They went to a Metroidvania, which is a kind of open world, which they haven't done before. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Alan Wake project, before it finally got released, it was in development hell for a long time, and Remedy had been building it as an open world game. You can see kind of portions of that concept as you play through that game in places that you maybe could have gotten access to if you had an open world kind of aesthetic. But Alan Wake ultimately wound up being a linear story-based progressive game, much like their Max Payne series before it. And I think they always wanted to try to do something that was kind of more holistic and of a single nature, like a Metroidvania. And so Control is that, and I'm happy to see them try it. Unfortunately, it's just kind of a weaker version of Alan Wake in terms of its narrative, its story, its characters. And at the end of the day, that's why I go to a Remedy game. I think the combat in Control, which is the last piece I want to talk about before we get into really talking about the narrative, is good. It's fun. It's enjoyable. It's not elite. It's not special, in my opinion. You're mostly shooting a gun at people that are also wielding guns. It's interesting to me that in that setup where you've got a Federal Bureau of people that deal with all manner of unknowable cosmic forces and interdimensional incursions, that at the end of the day, the monsters here are really people. You know, they look like people that are just SWAT team members that have been possessed, and they have a little bit of red glow about them. And you shoot them just like you were playing in, you know, SOCOM or Call of Duty or Uncharted or anything else. That there really isn't a lot of interesting things that pop out of the other dimensions for you to fight. Some of them float in the air, which is, you know, interesting. But for the most part, they're throwing rocks at you. They all look the same. There's a shield enemy. And it feels very much like Destiny, in that there are people that run around and they do what they do with their guns, and they've got some shield enemies, and you got to prioritize a little bit, and you pull things off the walls and throw them, and that's the game. Really, pulling things off the walls or finding objects in your environment is the highlight of the game. It's the one trick that Control does that works really well. It has excellent animation to go with it. It has a lot of objects that you can pull and throw and that interact with the environment around them. You know, papers come off the desk and things of that nature. And that's a lot of fun in and of itself. In my opinion, it wears thin over the course of a 10-plus hour game because it's really the main trick that the game does. And the enemies, while they come in different assortments, they don't really progress very much. Even at the end of the game, you're mostly fighting the same kind of groups of enemies that you're fighting otherwise. There are some optional boss battles, which, in my opinion, are more frustrating than good. They really don't advance different kind of concepts. They just give people a lot of ads or a lot of health. But ultimately, at the end of the day, you're running around. You've got good movement. You've got good animation. The gameplay is satisfying. The combat is fun. And I think when you see all these positive reviews about the game, that's ultimately what it comes down to. You know, you had a lot of people that when they talk about Alan Wake, I think everybody liked the story, liked the structure of the game, liked the environment, liked the mood, liked the setting. I don't think you can argue too much against that, although Alan Wake is a little bit more open-ended than I know that some would like. But the action of Alan Wake is mostly shining a flashlight on bad guys and running away from them or dodging their melee attacks and things like that. And I know a lot of people had an issue with that, didn't think the action was good enough. For me, it was good enough. I think that that was exactly the kind of action that you should have to backstop a game that's going to be more story-focused, more character-focused, more narrative-focused. I feel much the same way about The Witcher 3, which I know gets a lot of complaints about its action, but I don't want the action to be the focus of a game like that. I want it to be functional. I want it to be something that puts you in the shoes of the person in that, in Alan Wake's case, a kind of professorial writer type that maybe doesn't have a lot of action. And in The Witcher's case, somebody that has to go and prepare for battle to such a great extent before it happens that ultimately when you wind up getting into the battle, hopefully it's a fairly non-event, that puts you in the shoes of the Witcher character, much like you're in the shoes of the Alan Wake character. In Control, you're Jesse Faden. She has all these psychic powers. She can levitate. She can throw things. And she runs around a lot, very similar to the characters in Quantum Break. And so I think that that's a lot more fun for a lot of people. And so I think that's why you're getting some of those reviews. Unfortunately, I look at it from a narrative perspective and see that that action is really in service of nothing. And so this is where the major spoilers are going to come in. Obviously, we've had a few light spoilers already. But in terms of the narrative, it's something we've got to talk about. We especially have to talk about it in relation to Alan Wake because it is one of my favorite games of all time. But the narrative of this game is pretty tortured, I think. We already talked about the environmental detail, but we'll start there. The environment of this game is essentially built as a kind of faux secure contain protect website, which is called SCP. It's a website you can go to right now that basically features authors putting together these fake government documents about artifacts and items that have weird reactions and basically represent the paranormal on Earth in ways that we wouldn't expect. And so Remedy has taken this concept of this website and said, we are going to draft a lot of documents that talk about weird artifacts, that talk about weird things, and we're going to place them all around our office building because the Federal Bureau of Control is dealing with these various weird things in the universe, in the world, and so we can populate all of our collectibles with all of these kinds of files. They are somewhat fun. I think there's some good writing there. I enjoyed reading a number of them. I read really all of the ones that I could find. However, they do one of the really big things that I don't like in video games, which is that they are color for the sake of color. There are very, very few of these documents that really relate to what you are doing in the game, that relate to your personal character journey or plot journey through the game. Mostly they are interesting things. This tree talks to people, you know, this television eats things. Whatever it is, a lot of documentation is designed to be funny or designed to be interesting or weird, and it just exists to exist in order to kind of populate this world. I generally don't have a problem with that, and I wouldn't have a problem with it at all if it was in service to a story, a narrative that was interesting. And here's where the main problem comes in. In Control, you play as this character, Jesse Faden. She is a strong woman. She comes into the game and finds that the original director of the Federal Bureau of Control, as of that evening, has shot himself in the head. And by taking control of the gun that he did it with, which is itself what they call an object of power in this game, after passing a test, she becomes the new director. Only she doesn't really want it. And as she goes through this game, she winds up talking to another character, which sounds a little bit like talking to you, as certainly in the early stages of the game, which comes by the name of Polaris, which you realize is essentially a being that has traveled with her. If you're getting kind of Stephen King vibes from all this, we're going to dive even deeper into that because it has a very Stephen King-esque story. As it turns out, all in the past, all before this game takes place, she and her brother had found a slide projector, which was itself an object of power, that opened up realms to different dimensions. And when this happened, when she was a kid, the Federal Bureau of Control came in, seized the slide projector and the slides after she had burned most of the slides, and her brother, Dylan. And she had come to the Federal Bureau of Control at the start of the game to find her brother, and she does so probably about halfway through the game. She finds her brother. She determines that the slide projector had been seized by the Federal Bureau of Control. It turns out, as part of the plot line, that it was through that slide projector that she had gotten Polaris in her brain. There are some narrative beats about whether the Federal Bureau has control of Polaris, and it turns out that they really don't, because Polaris is what they call a resonance entity and exists kind of as a resonance, just like the enemies do in this game, which they call the Hiss. And you get to the end of the game, you fight some more Hiss. Your brother doesn't really do anything of much import. You try to cleanse him. He goes into a coma. The Hiss are still in the building, and the game ends. And throughout this entire thing, Jesse really doesn't change. There is no character arc for Jesse. She comes in knowing about the paranormal because of those past events. She comes in happy to be at the Federal Bureau of Control, but not so happy to be named director. She doesn't like authority positions. And if you're going to characterize her arc as anything at the end of the game, is that she accepts her role as director of the Federal Bureau of Control, although she's not going to run it the same way that her predecessors did. And that's the entire story. As I said at the in respect to the ending, you don't get any kind of comfort as to what Dylan's role in the story was, whether he will recover or not. You don't get any comfort as to even leaving the building because the Hiss are still in it at the end. It just kind of stops. It stops without a boss battle. You just fight Hiss a little bit more towards the end. And then it just cuts to credits with you accepting your role as the director. Now, you can run around. There's some endgame stuff. And that is great, I guess. But it's not anything that actually represents a character arc as we might recognize it. Jesse exists at point A when she starts the game and really finishes at point A plus or A minus, depending on your perspective. Dylan is introduced as the reason that she's seeking out the Federal Bureau of Control, but it's evident that Polaris, the voice in her brain, was leading her there anyway for reasons that aren't entirely clear. As a matter of fact, towards the end of the game, or maybe even in the post game, there's a conversation she has where essentially she says, "I don't think we'll ever understand any of this, and I'm okay with it." And it reminded me so much of Destiny saying, "I don't have time to explain what I don't have time to explain." All of this kind of hand-wringing. And I don't know. Maybe it's just Star Wars. Maybe it's just having to deal with Episode 9 coming out in a couple months from my perspective. But I am sick to death of mystery boxes. I'm sick to death of folks putting out into the world things that don't have answers, things that are just mysterious for the sake of being mysterious. Now, I don't need full-on explanations of every I dotted and every T crossed. I think that's actually the opposite of what I'm looking for. But we do need to have a plot that makes some modicum of sense. I have no idea why Dylan, her brother, is in the game at all. As it turns out, when you get to the end of the plot, it's actually the previous director that had introduced the Hiss. It wasn't her brother, as evil as he sounds in the middle of the game. Her brother doesn't do much of anything except be the final conduit for the Hiss at the end of the game. But you don't fight him. You cleanse him when you get there. And he doesn't seem to have a role at all. It strikes me as something that maybe was different as part of the game development process for Control. Another thing that kind of jumps out at me there is you have a series of BioWare conversations that have dialogue elements that are introduced as kind of questions or things that you might otherwise answer as a player character. And much like a BioWare game, you might select a morality or a yes or no response. And always, there is no kind of response that the player can give there. Jesse will think about it, and then she will respond herself. And it struck me while I'm playing it that this seemed like it was something that was pulled out. That they were going for a more BioWare-esque approach where you were going to have dialogue options, potentially a branching narrative of some kind. And they wound up pulling that out at some point in development. That's what it felt like to me. I have no reason to believe that other than while I was playing, it really felt like that. So, you know, take that with a grain of salt. But it did feel like that was something that was changed. And obviously with Alan Wake going from open world to linear, Remedy has a history of essentially taking these big swats at big ideas and changing them, paring them back to make a functional game, which is to their credit. But that's really the plot of the game. The characters don't move. The characters that you interact with, some are interesting. For the most part, they're not. I will tell you one part that is off-putting for a fan of Remedy, like myself, is that all of the characters in the game are basically portrayed by actors that have already portrayed significant Remedy heroes or heroines. In this case, the previous director, Nathaniel Trench, of the Federal Bureau of Control is played by Max Payne himself. And so if you're familiar with Max Payne, it's a very, very specific sounding voice. And so you hear Max Payne every time he talks. Similarly, the second in command at the Federal Bureau of Control, which is, I don't remember his first name, but it's Dr. Darling, who's kind of in charge of research and development at the Bureau, is played by the person that plays Alan Wake. So you can hear Alan Wake's voice every time they appear, every time they say something in the game. So you have Max Payne and Alan Wake as your primary focal points for storytelling. Now, these two characters primarily don't have arcs themselves. They have exposition dumps. We talked about the fact that it turns out that Nathaniel Trench, the previous director, wound up letting the bad guys in essentially immediately before the events of the game. And that's, a somewhat big reveal, although I don't think that it was essentially anything that you didn't think could have been a possibility from the very outset of the game. And Darling has his own little plot where you have to figure out exactly what he's thinking as you go through the videos that you find where he's talking about the Federal Bureau of Control and its various divisions. But ultimately, since you've got Max Payne, since you've got Alan Wake, since your main character is actually the same actress that played Beth Wilder in Quantum Break, who had, in my opinion, by far the best plot line in Quantum Break, where she had to deal with essentially a closed loop time cycle and what that meant for her character and her past self and her present self. And I highly, highly recommend it. I highly recommend Quantum Break if for no reason other than the Beth Wilder plot line, because I think it's fantastic. But to then have that actress portray this kind of inert Jesse Faden character that really doesn't change, really doesn't have opinions on anything, already is fully accepting of the paranormal from moment one of the game. You don't have any fish out of water element in the game. You don't have anybody catching up like the audience to the events of the game. I really think that that in and of itself were choices that Remedy made that could have been avoided, where you find some other actors, you don't have this impact. Now, maybe there aren't enough people that are big Remedy fans that would recognize all these voices. To me, it's pretty obvious, and it was immediately off-putting 20 minutes into the game. But since the story winds up being about essentially nothing, I don't know that it's the biggest deal in the world. I really do liken this to Destiny 1, which, if you played that game, had a gameplay loop. The 30 seconds of fun, as Bungie likes to call it, that was excellent. Destiny is elite. It has some of the best first-person shooting in gaming. But it was all in service of nothing. There was no story there. Now, Kotaku and some other places would ultimately kind of do the expose on Destiny's development and show that Destiny had been a story of some kind and had all of that story elements ripped out with 6 months to go before going gold. And so they pieced it back together as well as they could and then put a bunch of story elements into what they called the Grimoire, which were basically poems and stories that related to the universe of Destiny, but not to the story and characters that you were dealing with. And that's what Control feels like to me. It's got a 30 seconds of fun loop that is good. You get to play with physics. You get to pull things off the wall. You get to throw them at baddies. And it is fun. I don't think it's as elite as Destiny. I think it's essentially pedestrian. It's good slash maybe sometimes great in very specific circumstances like the ashtray maze. But ultimately, it's that 30 seconds of fun loop that is as satisfying as it is in service of nothing. There's no story to Control, and when you get to the end, it's essentially an anticlimax. And so I think that's what we're looking at with Control, as opposed to something like Alan Wake, which has this narrative, has this story foundation that can compel you through, even if maybe the gameplay isn't working a huge amount for you. And that's always going to be unique to the individual player, right? That's me. I care about narrative. I care about why I am doing what I'm doing. That has to drive me forward. The gameplay is good. It has to be enough to make me not hate the actual process of playing the game. But at a fundamental level, just like a movie or a TV show or a book, I have to care about the structure of what I am doing to want to continue to do it. And I didn't feel that in Control. I felt a character that didn't really care what was going on, was fighting these bad guys because they had to fight these bad guys, and then an end of the game where the bad guys aren't entirely defeated, the person you're looking for isn't awake, and you essentially just accept a directorship that you got in the first 10 minutes of the game anyway, and the arc of really not accepting it to becoming accepting of it didn't really coalesce in any fashion that I could tell. If you're going to have your final beat be I'm accepting of being the director, you have to have a stronger rejection at the outset. You have to have reasons for that. You have to have something that binds you to that character. And I think what they were going for was a certain amount of aloofness. They were keeping a certain amount of mystery, much like a J.J. Abrams movie or anything else that kind of predicates itself on a mystery box approach. They wanted you to not understand who Jesse was talking to in those early cutscenes. And by the time you get to the end, you understand what she was talking about, but virtually everything important in her life and everything that happened between her and her brother and the Federal Bureau of Control happened before the game started. Before the game took place, and everything else in terms of collectibles is almost entirely related to just random things that they do in the universe. Finally, I wanted to talk a little bit about Alan Wake. Now, if you're a big Alan Wake fan and you saw Control and you saw it was dealing with the supernatural and the paranormal, you probably had some hopes in the back of your head that they would make an Alan Wake reference. One of my favorite bits of Quantum Break is actually you're going through a college university in Quantum Break, and on one of the blackboards that you can stop at while you're running against goons or whatever it is that you're doing is an entire dissection of the meta context and what's happening in the Alan Wake game, which is about a writer who can create a reality through his writing and another writer who may have created the first writer or maybe was created by the second writer to create the first writer and all this good stuff that I love about Alan Wake. And they have this huge blackboard that talks about all of the themes, all of the context, all of the characters in Alan Wake, and I love it to death. And it means that a university in Quantum Break was studying the story elements of Alan Wake, which I think is absolutely a course that I would take. In this game, it's not that. Alan Wake isn't a narrative device. It's not a novel. It's not a video game. It's real. And so in this context, the Federal Bureau of Control has been investigating the altered world event that took place at Cauldron Lake, which is the Alan Wake setting, and also detailing certain things about the objects of power that relate so specifically to the Alan Wake game. And I think that that's great. That's interesting. Remedy's clearly proud of Alan Wake. The problem I have with it is introducing it in this context demystifies it, right? So Alan Wake has a quote that I've always really loved. It's the very first thing you hear when you start that game, and it says, Stephen King once wrote, "Nightmares exist outside of logic, and there's little fun to be had in explanation. They're antithetical to the poetry of fear. In a horror story, the victim keeps asking why, but there can be no explanation, and there shouldn't be one. The unanswered mystery is what stays with us the longest, and it's what we'll remember in the end." And even reading that quote, I can see the panning shots around the mountains and all the good stuff in Alan Wake. But ultimately, what this quote is saying is that in the kind of story that Alan Wake was telling, which is not the same story as Control is telling, you don't want to have everything described to a T. In a fantasy world, you don't want to have science come in and explain the magic. In a horror world, you don't want to have science come in and explain everything that's happening. And by putting Alan Wake into this kind of Control prism, here's the primary problem I have with it. It adds midichlorians to Alan Wake. If you're not familiar with that reference, the Star Wars prequels are pretty famous, especially Phantom Menace, for taking the concept of the Force and trying to add a scientific description to it. Now, I didn't really necessarily mind it in that context, but a lot of people did mind it, that the Force was supposed to be this mystical power related to, you know, Zen Buddhism and all these other things that you can bring into the Star Wars universe. And by having someone essentially test someone's blood for Forceness, it took away some of that magic. And in this case, having a federal bureau and essentially discuss in business memos the nature of this awesome, meta-contextual, mystical adventure that you go on with Alan Wake, and actually have Alan Wake not exactly make an appearance, but have a message delivered through one of the memos, talking about the light switch, talking about what Cauldron Lake is, it demystifies it in a way that I don't love. I'm very happy to see that Alan Wake continues to live in their hearts, and I'm hopeful that if there's an Alan Wake 2 at any point in the future, it goes back to what made Alan Wake Alan Wake and doesn't really take too much out of Control, as in terms of Control demystifying and analyzing what makes Alan Wake Alan Wake. But at least in playing Control, I'm not a big fan of saying, hey, the light switch is an object of power that does this, and that's why it worked in Alan Wake, and Cauldron Lake is this, and hey, Alan Wake is stuck in this other dimension, and that's why it does this. I don't like any of that. I don't like any of that explanation. It feels very much like saying midichlorians are the Force. And so while I love that Remedy still cares about Alan Wake, I think only a couple months before Control came out, we saw that Alan Wake's rights had all come back to Remedy. So there's now a chance that Remedy could make an Alan Wake sequel using their own resources. And I think they're going to make a good deal of money from Control. So I think that's great for them. But ultimately, I just didn't care for the way they treated Alan Wake and that property in Control, even though that was the context that it basically had to be treated in for purposes of this game in and of itself. So that's Control for me. As I said, it's something like a 4 out of 10 for me. It's the most disappointing game of the year because I go to Remedy games for narrative. I loved Quantum Break's narrative. I loved Alan Wake's narrative. Control does not have one. They focus their efforts on something else, whether that's building the environment for a Metroidvania, whether that's compelling the action in a specific way, spending all those resources on animations and that kind of thing. More power to them. I think they're getting a lot of traction from a lot of people that aren't me, and I'm never going to ever say anything bad about people that find enjoyment out of a video game, movie, or otherwise that I didn't enjoy. I think that's great. I wish I could be you. But for me, the narrative was so nothing, was so Destiny 1-esque, characters that really didn't have a lot of interesting things to say in service of a story that didn't go anywhere at all, that I can't help but look at this as a significant missed opportunity for what could have been really, really cool. I love Remedy games. I will continue to love them. I think that their next game will be something that I also anticipate. I hope they go a different direction from Control. They can keep the fun action if that's what they want, but I hope they really focus on story, on narrative, on character, and on actually making something that I want to play with their now much better action elements. If I want to play it, if I'm compelled to that next room, to that next environment, and not to the next gray, brutalist cafeteria, I think that's something that's going to work better for me. And hopefully you keep your new fans that have come on board with Control that really like throwing psychic rocks at flying, floating monster people with guns. And that's really it. That's my postmortem for Control. If you like this video, if you like this podcast, please like, please subscribe. We talk about a lot of things, but we talk about law, business, video games, movies, pop culture, postmortems, impressions of things, and certainly the primary series on the channel, Virtual Legality, talks about all those issues at length with primary source material talking about terms and conditions, the way the law intersects with the business of video games, and other things of that nature. Otherwise, if you caught this postmortem on YouTube, thank you so much for watching. If you listen to it in its podcast format, thank you so much for listening. Share it around to anybody you think might be interested. And in this case, rather than Virtual Legality, I will catch you on the very next postmortem that we put up on the Hoeg Law YouTube channel. Thank you so much.